but it's only because I want to put on record the purpose of the message of last week, this week, the next couple of weeks to come. I don't want to be misunderstood. It seems as if I have a personal vendetta or a personal grudge or a difficulty with my past denomination, which is the Seventh-day Adventist Church, of which I was a member. I was born in that church. I studied theology in that church. I was a pastor in that church. My father was a pastor in that church. I want to clarify that I don't have an issue with one denomination. I have an issue with any teaching, with any denomination that is not biblical. To that end, I've been given the privilege by the Canadian Association of Lutheran Churches to study Scripture and also work with the Lutheran Church to examine the doctrines. The Lutheran Church, the president of the Lutheran Church, and the elders group has organized and agreed, and actually they're in the middle of organizing, a protocol through which we can go and study those teachings that may be more traditional than biblical. And if there's anything non-biblical, they're prepared to review it and assess it, then take it to their seminary, which is a good way to go. I hope that as time goes on, we will have opportunity to study other doctrines that are held by other so-called Christian denominations. And I think it's important. The reason it's important is because just over a year ago, we came together as a group. And it becomes important for us to identify what it is that we believe. And if we believe something that is not biblical, it becomes incumbent upon us to cleanse ourselves of anything that is not biblical. It just so happens that when we came to worship by ourselves or within this group, a discussion came up about one of the doctrines of the Seventh-day Adventist Church, which is really the foundational doctrine of the Seventh-day Adventist Church, which is the 1844 investigative judgment doctrine. Out of that discussion came the need to study deeper teachings and where they came from. And so for that reason, we began to study. And I am now presenting the things that I've found and that I continue to find. And I want to invite every Seventh-day Adventist member to go back and examine everything that I'm saying. Don't just say, oh, never mind, he's just anti-Adventist, or he's from the beast or from the devil. Don't. Just go back and take your Bibles and study. Not just the Bibles, take the Adventist history and study. Further, I would like to invite and challenge Seventh-day Adventist pastors to be honest with their Bibles and with their truth. And I want to invite these pastors to stand up and be counted, because you will have to answer to God for what you're teaching. And if you know that what you're teaching is not biblical, it's your responsibility. The Bible tells us those that are given much, there will be much more demanded, expected. The leaders of the Adventist Church, there comes a time when you have to be honest with yourself and truthful. You need to examine what you have been taught, what you are learning and teaching, and whether or not you yourself are being honest with your research. The theologians, you know much more than I do. But rather than covering, rather than hiding the truths about the lies, we need to come clean. So I will continue to do the work that I am asked to do, and that is to lift up Jesus Christ and only the Bible as the Word of God. To that end, in order for me to examine the doctrine of the investigative judgment, which I believe is really a doctrine that is couched, which is hid underneath the teachings of the Roman Catholic Church, which says you come to God by faith and grace. But once there, you have to then earn your righteousness by your life. And it is by that that you are judged. At a later time, I will show the historical path of this teaching, how it found its way into the Adventist Church, by the pioneers and where they came from, and how that teaching came past and through the Reformation and still remains in the church. Besides that particular teaching, there's also, in order to support that teaching, there are other false non-biblical teachings. The date of 1844 and what happened then. The teaching that people were sealed at that time and there was no more time for confession of sin. The teaching of the Day of Atonement and the scapegoat, who the scapegoat is. Teaching of the 144,000, who they are. And that the spirit of prophecy, really, as shown in the book of Revelation, means it's the writings of Ellen White, that Ellen White has the gift of prophecy. These are teachings that are erroneous, that are wrong, that are lies. And the way to judge that is to see how do they stand against the truths of the Bible, where the fundamental foundation of the biblical truth is the covenant of Abraham, where God says, through Abraham, I will provide seed and a land so that through that land the seed may prosper and be successful, and through that seed all nations of the earth would be blessed and saved. So salvation to the entire world comes through the covenant of Abraham. And the covenant of Abraham, we know that it is a covenant which was given by God between God and Abraham. It was one-sided, and God said, you don't have to do anything. I will give you whatever I have promised. And the Bible tells us, Romans chapter 4, verse 13, Romans chapter 4, verse 2 and 3, that was by faith, it was by faith that Abraham was counted righteous, but not by works. Genesis 15, 16, the Bible tells us, and Abraham believed and it was counted to him righteousness. So the grace, the righteousness that is given to Abraham is given to us. Romans chapter 4, 13 tells us that it is given to us also as it was given to Abraham. And when that message of grace, that message, the foundational message of the gospel that is in the covenants from Genesis to Revelation, when that is attacked, we have to examine what is the doctrines that is attacking it and how. And how. I want you to go with me to Galatians chapter 2. We've been following Galatians for the last couple of weeks. And it's important for us to emphasize as we go through our studies that we remain within the covenantal teachings. That what we're teaching, that what we're studying is in fact biblical. Galatians chapter 3, verses 1 to 14. I am astonished that you are so quickly deserting the one who called you to live in the grace of Christ and are turning to a different gospel, which is really no gospel at all. What this is talking about is the people in Galatia were going back to the teaching that you are saved by grace, but once you're saved, you've got to live a life and you've got to be a righteous person. And your righteousness is counted by God towards your eternal life. But evidently, some people are throwing you into confusion and are trying to pervert the gospel of Christ. But even if we or an angel from heaven should preach a gospel other than the one preached to you, let them be under God's curse. as we have already said, now I say again, if anybody is preaching to you a gospel other than that you have accepted, let them be under God's curse. For I am now trying to win approval. For am I now trying to win the approval of human beings or of God? Or am I trying to please the people? If I were still trying to please people, I would not be a servant of Christ. I want you to know, brothers and sisters, that the gospel I preached is not of human origin. I want you to pay attention to this. The gospel that I preached is not of human origin. I did not receive it from any man, nor was I taught it. Rather, I received it by revelation from Jesus Christ. This is a very, very important text in today's sermon. And why? The Apostle Paul says clearly that the message that I have for you, the message of salvation by grace alone, and he verifies what that is. And to verify it, he goes to chapter 3, and there he talks about it. Understand then, verse 7, that those who have faith are children of Abraham. Scripture foresaw that God would justify Gentiles by what? By faith. And he announced the gospel in advance to Abraham. God had the gospel plan all the way when God first talked to Abraham. It was nothing new. It was nothing new. All nations, he says, will be blessed through you. So those who rely on faith are blessed along with Abraham, the man of faith. For all who rely on the works of the law are under a curse. As it is written, cursed is everyone who does not continue to do everything written in the book of the law. Clearly, no one who relies on the law is justified before God. The law is not based on faith. On the contrary, it says the person who does these things will live by them. Christ redeemed us from the curse of the law by becoming a curse for us. For it is written, cursed is everyone who is hung on a pole. He redeemed us in order that the blessing given to Abraham might come to the Gentiles through Christ Jesus, so that by faith we might receive the promise of what? The promise of the Spirit. Promise of the Spirit. I want to go back to chapter 1, verse 12. I did not receive it from any man, nor was I taught it. Rather, I received it by revelation from Jesus Christ. The Seventh-day Adventist Church that claims new doctrines, some of the ones that I just mentioned, they claim those doctrines based on certain passages in the Bible using a biblical, let's call it a biblical system of study that we call proof texting. A text here and a text there doesn't really apply to anything at all, and it actually dishonestly using some texts. If you go to the Fundamental Beliefs of the Seventh-day Adventist Church and look at the belief number 18, which is about the gift of prophecy, they cite the following Bible passages to support Ellen White as the prophet. Numbers 12:6, 2 Chronicles 20:20, Joel 2:28, Acts 2:14-21, Revelation 12:17, Revelation 19:10. When you take these Bible texts and you study them to study what they really mean, they don't point to any new prophet at all. Not at all. Well, let's look at them. What is Joel 2:20? Let's go to Acts chapter 2, verse 14-21. The reason I want to go there, because this is the most common and the strongest text that they use. And by the way, I should tell you, I spent all my life using the same passages. Acts chapter 2, verse 16. I look at verse 17. In the last days, And by the way, this is what you will be cited. Verse 17, in the last days, God says, I will pour out my spirit on all people. Your sons and daughters will prophesy. Your young men will see visions. Your old men will dream dreams. Even on my servants, both men and women. This is very important for them. I will pour out my spirit in those days, and they will prophesy. I will show wonders in the heavens above, and the signs on the earth below, blood and fire and billows of smoke. The sun will be turned to darkness and the moon to blood before the coming of the great and glorious day of the Lord. And everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. I want to point out a couple of things here. This is a passage that Adventists claim proves and supports that Ellen White is the fulfillment of that prophecy of the apostle that the prophet Joel talked about in chapter 2, verse 28. If this is not a lie, it is just bad exegesis. It is just bad interpretation of Scripture. Why? Because rather than a Seventh-day Adventist leader or Adventist quote prophet claiming that this is the prophecy of Joel, why don't we read what the Bible says this is? Fellow Jews, this is Peter speaking, verse 14 of chapter 2. Then Peter stood up with the 11, raised his voice, addressed the crowd. Fellow Jews, and all of you who live in Jerusalem, let me explain this to you. Listen carefully to what I have to say. These people are not drunk, as you suppose. It's only 9 in the morning. No! This is what was spoken by the prophet Joel. So, when Peter was preaching, and this prophesying is not a time prophecy. This is not predictions. This is a proclamation prophecy. The word prophecy has two meanings. A time meaning and a space meaning. The time meaning projecting forward what's going to happen. And Jesus gave us some time prophecies. Outside of that, there are those who like to go to the Apostle Paul and say, yeah, the Apostle Paul in 1 Thessalonians 5 is giving a time prophecy. He is not. The Apostle Paul is quoting a prophecy from the Old Testament. Let's be good students of Scripture. The prophecy in the New Testament is all proclamation that Jesus came as a fulfillment of the prophecy of the Old Testament. And the 16 prophets of the Old Testament, altogether they had about 2,000 visions, 2,000 messages through visions and dreams. And not one of them was wrong. The prophet of the Seventh-day Adventist Church, Ellen White, made about 2,000 visions by herself, approximately. And all of them were wrong. All of them. The most important ones I'm going to review with you today. And by the way, the other passages that are used by Seventh-day Adventists to show that these are people of God. It says, Revelation 12:7, he says, those that keep the commandments. Here are those that keep the commandments of God. Who are those that keep the commandments of God? And what they say, what they tell us is, oh, the fourth commandment shines brighter. So you know who keeps all the commandments of God by those who keep the seventh-day Sabbath. Now, I don't diminish the importance of the Sabbath at all. I believe that I lift up the importance of the Sabbath more than the Adventist teaching does. Because I believe the Bible teaches us. The Sabbath pre-existed Sinai. It is a sign between us and our Creator. But let's not misuse it. They say, those that keep the Sabbath are those that follow the commandments of God. No! When Jesus points out, he says, here are those that keep the commandments, are those that have accepted Jesus Christ and are covered by the blood and the life of Jesus Christ. And as such, they keep all the commandments of God because Jesus kept them on our behalf. So everybody who is sealed, not by the Sabbath, everybody who is sealed by Jesus is the ones who in the book of Revelation who are saved. Abhorrent teaching. A terrible teaching. Revelation 19:10 is what they use to say, this is the spirit of prophecy. And thus they call the prophecies of Ellen White the spirit of prophecy. Not at all. We won't have time today to go into that because I want to go in detail with you with some of the primary doctrines that Ellen White taught and she had visions of. And what I'm going to show you is exactly the opposite of what the Apostle Paul told us in Galatians chapter 2, verse 12. Well, 11 and 12. I'm going to read it again. Please, Galatians chapter 1, verses 11 and 12. If you've never paid attention to this before, and if you're a Seventh-day Adventist, please pay attention. I want you to know, brothers and sisters, that the gospel I preached is not of human origin. I did not receive it from any man, nor was I taught it. Rather, I received it by revelation from Jesus Christ. Ellen White makes the exact same claim. She makes the exact same claim. She writes, she says, every word that I have written in my articles, in my books, was given to me by God. Every word. And yet, when you study her visions for all of the major doctrines, you find that somebody else taught it before. And she took it from them and claimed that it was in vision that she got that teaching. I want to go over a few of those details with you today. First, New York, Eastern U.S., was inundated in the early 1800s with religious revivalism. There were so many revivals and so many preachers in that central part of New York that the name for that area historically is now called the Burned Out District. There was so much hellfire being preached there. The end of the world, that's called the Burned Out District. And out of that movement grew many other movements, including the Seventh-day Adventists, the Mormons, and the Jehovah's Witnesses. One of the movements that was very, very popular was one called the Millerite Movement by William Miller. William Miller was not a trained theologian, student of the Bible, but in his own effort and in all sincerity, he was studying, the book of Daniel and Revelation, books of Daniel and Revelation, and using the prophecies of Daniel 8, he began to estimate what that means and when this will be. He came up with a date of 1844, initially 1843. And he said, Jesus is going to come back. By the way, I'm not going to have time to discuss the details of each of these doctrines. I'm only going to show that Ellen White did not get these from God in vision, that she got them from humans. Just as the Apostle Paul says, I didn't get it from men, she did. That's the point. So William Miller began teaching that Jesus was going to return in 1843. He didn't. Then he says, well, no, it wasn't 1843. Before long, actually, they expected between March and approximately October, sometime in 1843, Jesus would come. But then they said, oh, no, the date was wrong. It's going to be in 1844, more specifically, October 22. Ellen White wrote several times that God showed her that William Miller was exactly right about the date, October 22, 1844. This man has now been teaching and converting lots of people in Europe, in America, on the West Coast, on the East Coast, all over America. People are leaving their own denominations and following William Miller. People are selling their farms, selling their goods, getting ready for the coming of Jesus Christ. And Ellen White says that she had a vision that Jesus was going to return on October 22, 1844. Where did that come from? Was that a vision from God? It was a miscalculation by William Miller. And when Jesus didn't come in 1844, before too long, William Miller gave up and he confessed. He says, I was wrong. I was wrong. And the man died. There were some who didn't give up, who wanted to believe that Jesus was coming. One of them was Joseph Turner. Joseph Turner was a man who came up with this idea that in 1844, Jesus was not going to come back to this earth, but that the gate to heaven, the door to heaven, was going to be shut. And he used the parable of those 10 virgins, 5 foolish and 5 intelligent ones. Now, once a door is closed, it is too late. And Joseph Turner began to teach that the door to salvation is shut on October 22, 1844. Ellen White had access to Joseph Turner's article that he had written in a magazine. In 1847, she wrote a letter to Joseph Bates. And she says that, yes, there was the article that he wrote in my home, but I didn't read it. Not one word of it. What's interesting is one day, this is when, still in 1845, actually, she was concerned that Jesus didn't come and that she had this new information, and what was she going to do with it? So she got in a sleigh being pulled by a horse about 5 miles, 4 to 5 miles, to the home of Joseph Turner, the same man. She says she didn't talk to him in one account. In another account, she says she did talk to him. But she said she quietly just went upstairs to the second floor and slept in his bed for 2 hours. But didn't talk to him about it. So she went in the snow and the cold all the way about 4 miles, but didn't talk to the guy about anything. That night, Joseph Turner held a meeting. And in that meeting, he gave his opinion of what he had found. He says, I think this is what happened. In October 22, 1844, what happened was that the door to heaven was shut. Ellen White says that she was not at the meeting. The day following this meeting, Ellen White made a speech, a public speech. And in that speech, she repeated everything that Joseph Turner said. That God had shown her that October 22, 1844 was really the day that the door to heaven was shut. This is what they call the shut door prophecy in the Adventist Church. And how important was it? Ellen White says in the book Great Controversy that the shut door teaching is as strong and as important as the keeping of the commandments. The two go hand in hand, and they will forever remain equal. Not long after, God had shown her this, the shut door prophecy, that she stole off of Joseph Turner. But before too long, she said, no, that was a mistake. God has given me new light. Adventists for many years, taught the shut door prophecy of Ellen White. The point here is not the details of the doctrine. We'll do all of that later. The point is, once again, not like the Apostle Paul, who said he got everything from God. She got it from a man, Joseph Turner. During that same time, Ellen White and her husband met a man named Joseph Bates. Joseph Bates had a lot more influence on the Adventist church than Adventists admit. Seventh-day Adventists were not the first to acknowledge the seventh day as the Sabbath. And by the way, for Adventists, you've got to stop saying that the seventh day is a day of worship. That's nonsense. Every day is a day of worship. Sabbath is the day of rest from sunset to sunset. All of it is sacred. All of it is sanctified.
When we say it's a day of worship, we diminish the rest of the Sabbath. We focus on what we call the divine hour. We forget the rest of the Sabbath. Joseph Bate brought the teaching of the Sabbath to Ellen White and to her husband. And before long, they accepted it. But Joseph Bates didn't accept Ellen White as a prophet. He wasn't interested. But this was a man of influence. He had money. We won't have time today to go into more details about him. Ellen White and her husband wanted to have that alignment with Joseph Bates. Not only did they accept his teaching of the Sabbath, Ellen White now began to have visions that were favorable to Joseph Bates. And this is when she had that vision. Now she saw in vision the Ten Commandments. And the fourth commandment was lit up. It was lit up brighter than all the others. Where in the Bible does it tell us that any one commandment is more important than the other? Nowhere. The Bible tells us every commandment is the same. That even the smallest of the ones is as if you have broken them all. Nowhere does it tell us. Completely anti-biblical. The other thing that Joseph Bates said was that between 1844 and 1851 is now when Jesus was going to come. Ellen White, by the way, came up with five different dates of the return of Jesus Christ. All shown to her by God. All of them. So to appease Joseph Bates and to agree with him, she began to also teach that now people will be sealed. But how are people going to be sealed? The end is going to be 1851. But how are people going to be sealed? And because Joseph Bates promoted the seventh-day Sabbath, he says, it'll be the Sabbath that'll be the mark of sealing God's people. It wasn't Ellen White. And it wasn't. Later on, the Adventists changed that. They say, there's going to be the Adventist eschatology. There's going to be a time. There's going to be a Sunday law in the whole world. And then all those who reject the seventh-day Sabbath are going to go to hell, and all those that accept it will be 144,000. But you understand, this is not from God, this is from a man. This was the same man who was a Navy sea captain and was an astronomer, and to gain favor with him, Ellen White claimed she had a vision we talked about last week, that she was taken by an angel to go to Saturn and Jupiter, where she saw moons, four moons on one, I think nine on the other, or seven, I can't remember. And they had giants who were beautiful who lived there. And Joseph Bates was so impressed, he says, where did you get that information? She says, I have no interest in science. I don't read. God gave me this. And by the way, for those who claim that Ellen White was not dishonest, that she borrowed from other writers innocently, I will deal with the whole question at a later time, but I just want to say this. When a person claims to be a prophet, and when a person claims that every word and line that they have came from God, when they begin to borrow from somebody else and don't give them credit, there is a problem. Whether the laws of plagiarism were in place or not is not material. What is material that she claims that it all came from God, and not one word, not one line came from another human being. So that basically disqualifies that wonderful sermon that Dwight Nelson preached to defend Ellen White and her plagiarism. But we'll deal with that more detail later. And before I go much further, I got to tell you, the information I'm sharing with you is not original from me. It is not my original research. There are many others who have done research. I've just had to go and seek it out. Joseph Bates was the provider of the teaching of the sealing, the Sabbath being the sealing of the people of God. And that the seventh day Sabbath was the Sabbath that ought to be observed. And Ellen White claimed that she got it in vision. She didn't get it in vision. She stole the idea from somebody else. Let's talk about the health message. That's the other thing Adventists are known for, aren't we? We talk about it. We got the biggest hospital system outside the Roman Catholic Church. We don't eat certain foods. We eat mostly vegetarian. We recommend we eat vegetarian food. We exercise. We do all these other things and so on. Well, Ellen White tells us that she got all this information and vision from God. In 1864, her son Willie got sick. And they had to take Willie to a special doctor who was very, very well known. And by then, Ellen White was a woman of means. They went to the specialist. And he was very well known, and his books were spread all over America, especially in the Northeast. This was a doctor who taught healthful living. He says, don't drink, don't smoke, don't eat sugars, eat vegetarian food, don't eat red meats, exercise, get some sunlight. Sound familiar? Ellen White came back from the doctor and from bringing her son back. And she began to teach this all over the place. And some people asked her, this sounds much like Dr. Jackson's work. She said, I have never known Dr. Jackson's work. God showed me this. What's interesting, that before she went to Dr. Jackson, there were some women around where Ellen White lived who had changed their mode of dress. And they began to dress very modestly. And to do that, rather than wearing the long dresses that would drag in the dirt, they would wear trousers and wear a shorter dress over top of the trousers so it would cover the top of the pants. Ellen White says, God does not want you to wear that. I was shown God doesn't want you to wear it. But when she went to see Dr. Jackson, she noticed over there that Dr. Jackson's daughter, who is also a doctor, was wearing that dress. And that doctor, Dr. Jackson's daughter, explained to her why. Well, this is healthier because we don't get all the, the horse manure on the roads and the mud. We don't get all that on our dresses, and we're cleaner, we're healthier. So Ellen White came back and said, now God has shown me that we all have to wear this dress. And all the women in the Adventist circles had to dress like that. And she herself dressed like that, but she didn't like it. Then when she moved away to California, she stopped wearing it and never talked about it again. It's a message from God. The greatest message of the Adventist Church, the special doctrine is called the sanctuary teaching, the Day of Atonement. Ellen White says she got it from God. Hiram Edson, an early pioneer in the Adventist Church, soon after the great disappointment, is walking down in the fields. And he has a vision, and he sees in that vision that Jesus is crossed over from the holy place into the most holy place. And so that is now what happened, is this is now the judgment that started in 1844 and on October 22. He went back and he started to share that. And as he shared that, and as it became known, he went for confirmation to Ellen White, and wouldn't you know, it was a good explanation, because nobody could go to heaven and check it out. Now Ellen White had a vision to follow the teaching of Hiram Edson. And in that vision, she sure enough, she saw Jesus going into the most holy place. Within the teaching of the temple, there is another doctrine which is very different than the mainstream teaching of the sanctuary. And that is on the Day of Atonement, there are two goats. We don't have time, so I'll go quickly. The second goat, the scapegoat. It is traditionally believed that the scapegoat is in fact Jesus, because the sins of the world were put on who? Jesus, that who was taken outside the gates of Jerusalem and died, killed there? It was Jesus. But Ellen White says she saw in vision that it was not Jesus, that the scapegoat was Satan, and the sins were put back on the heads of Satan. Not Jesus, Satan. So really, according to her teaching, who takes away our sins? Satan? Really? Is that from God? No. There's a man named O.R.L. Crozier who began to write about the scapegoat, and he wrote about the scapegoat long before Ellen White had her vision, and she had access to his teachings and began to teach the difference in the scapegoat. Now, the most important doctrine in the entire Bible from start to finish, from Genesis to Revelation, is what? That we are saved by grace. We're saved by grace. We see it right from Adam, when God covered Adam and Eve with the skin of the dead animals that he made for them. And we see it all the way in Revelation. Here are those that keep the commandments of God. God sees the righteous who are covered by Jesus Christ. Ellen White started prophesying in 1844, 45, thereabouts. 1844 is her first vision. I would think that if God was going to choose a prophet, the very first thing and the major item in his teaching would be justification by faith through grace. By grace through faith. Justification by grace through faith. That would be the first thing. That's the first thing the Apostle Paul talked about. That is the first and only thing that Luther talked about. Everything else was peripheral. I was reading a note the other day, a couple of weeks ago, from a church elder in the Roman Catholic Church, Erasmus. He writes to Luther, and he talks about the question of only faith, faith alone. And Luther responds and he says, I am happy that you didn't write to me about trivial things, because all of the things are trivial. You talk to me about the only important thing. That is what? That you're saved by faith. It would seem to me that the first thing God would teach a prophet would be that you're saved by grace through faith. For 44 years, Ellen White supposedly ministered as a prophet, but never, never talked about justification by faith. How is it? You talk about what to eat, what not to eat, what to wear, what not to wear. You talk about silly dates of different things happening, but you don't talk about why and how you're saved. In 1888, there was a general conference session in Minneapolis, and two Bible teachers came, A.T. Jones and E.J. Wagner. And they brought to the Adventist church the message of justification by faith. Now I ask you, if you're going to talk about the sanctuary and say that the judgment begins in the most holy place, in 1844, in October 22, if God gave you that, wouldn't God give you some insight about the daily sacrifices in that same sanctuary that are all about grace? You cannot understand the sanctuary system if you don't understand grace. And for 44 years, she didn't teach it. She didn't know it. She said about her husband and her that we have not heard this before. And then she says, oh, this is what I have been teaching for 15 years. Then she says, this is what I have been trying to teach for 15 years. And before too long, she began to have visions about justification by faith. And the men who brought this message to the Adventist church, they both left the church disappointed and didn't accept Ellen White as a prophet of God. This hideous, terrible, terrible misinterpretation of the Bible,
which denotes and demands and gives Adventists the claim that they are the remnant of God.
What makes them the remnant? Do you know? They believe they're the remnant because they keep the Sabbath.
Where in the Bible is anybody a remnant for keeping the Sabbath? The people were remnant. Who was remnant? Abraham was remnant. Isaac was remnant. Jacob was remnant. They were remnant because they had the faith in God. That's what made them remnant.
No doubt about it, the Sabbath was a sign of the Mosaic covenant with regards to going to the promised land.
But the work of the remnant was there that they may take the message of salvation to the whole world. And when that message became available to the whole world, anybody who is a believer in Jesus Christ becomes part of that remnant. No longer one nation, no longer one denomination, no longer one group. The entire world, where there are people who believe and lift up Jesus Christ and believe in grace through faith, become the remnant.
At the time of Ellen White, not only were there dozens, but there were hundreds of people claiming to be prophets. Hundreds of them. And we have record of them. We have their names, what they prophesied. But Ellen White was so convincing with her fraud that she was able to develop a denomination that today has 25 million people following. I wish those people would take their Bibles. I wish they would take the history of the Adventist Church and study it, because their salvation is at stake. Ellen White, Sister Mary, was married to a guy named Hazen Foss. And Adventist history teaches that God first went to Hazen Foss and asked him to be a prophet. But he didn't want to be. He had visions, but he didn't want to share the visions. So he told Ellen White, listen, I can't do the work of God that he's given me to do, to be a prophet and to share what God has given me. So God is going to ask you, but you must do it. But the problem is that the record of this meeting and the record of Hazen Foss saying this to Ellen White is not from Hazen Foss, it's from Ellen White. That Hazen Foss said to me that he has lost the Holy Spirit, and if I don't want to lose my salvation, I must be a prophet. It's pretty convenient. Another believer, Adventist, William Foy. William Foy was having visions. And if you look at the record of the visions that William Foy had, he had many weird visions. And Ellen White met with William Foy, had some discussions. William Foy had written about several of his visions. One night she was having a meeting, and there were people attending, lots of people attending. And she was telling a vision. And in the vision, she saw, we talked about this last week, that those angels of God that are given the responsibility to minister to this earth, when they come from heaven and go back to heaven, they are given a gold card to show to the guardian angels to see if they can come out of heaven and go back into heaven. And when she was giving that vision to the people, a man in the congregation stood up and started shouting, "Wait a minute, wait a minute, that's the vision I had." She didn't know that William Foy was there in attendance. Stealing the ideas and visions of men. We don't have time for more, but there is a lot more. I want to point your attention to a few Bible verses. If you would,
go with me to the Gospel of John. But before we do that, let's go to Corinthians. 1 Corinthians 2, 6 to 10. 1 Corinthians 2, 6 to 10. We do, however, speak a message of wisdom among the mature, but not the wisdom of this age or the rulers of this age who are coming to nothing. No, we declare God's wisdom a mystery that has been hidden and that God destined for our glory before time began. None of the rulers of this age understood it, for if they had, they would not have crucified the Lord of glory. However, it is written, what no eye has seen, what no ear heard, and what no human mind has conceived, the things God has prepared for those who love him, these are the things God has revealed to us by his Spirit. By his Spirit. It is the Spirit of God that opens our mind to the mysteries of God given in his Word. There is no need for another prophet to interpret for us what the Holy Spirit is to interpret for us. Go now to John chapter 14. John 14, verse 26. Let's go to verse 25. All this I have spoken while still with you, but the Advocate, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, will teach you all things and will remind you of everything I have said to you. Who will teach you all things? A false prophet? Who is going to determine and steal ideas from others? No, the Spirit is going to teach you all things. Go to John 16. John 16, verse 12 to 15. I have much more to say to you, more than you can now bear. But when he, the Spirit of truth, comes, he will guide you into all truth. He will not speak on his own. He will speak only what he hears. And he will tell you what is yet to come. He will glorify me because it is from me that he will receive what he will make known to you. All that belongs to the Father is mine. That is why I said, the Spirit will receive from me what he will make known to you. Who will make it known to you? The Spirit. The same Spirit who gave understanding to those who wrote the Scripture, uneducated people. That same Spirit will lead us. Go with me to Jeremiah. Jeremiah chapter 23. This is one of our texts from our scripture reading earlier today. Jeremiah 23. And there we'll read verses 24 on. Who can hide in secret places so that I cannot see them, declares the Lord. Do not I fill heaven and earth, declares the Lord? I have heard what the prophets say who prophesy lies in my name. Verse 24 basically gives us a setup. In other words, a prophet cannot lie on my behalf. Why? Because I know everything. So if you represent God, you know that God knows everything. I have heard what the prophets say who prophesy lies in my name. They say, I had a dream. I had a vision. How long will this continue in the hearts of these lying prophets who prophesy the delusions of their own minds? They think the dreams they tell one another will make my people forget my name, just as their ancestors forgot my name through Baal worship. Let the prophet who has a dream recount the dream, but let the one who has my work speak it faithfully, for what has straw to do with grain, declares the Lord. Is not my word like fire, declares the Lord, and like a hammer that breaks a rock in pieces?
Therefore, declares the Lord, I am against the prophets who steal from one another words supposedly from me. Are you listening to this? Are you listening to this? I am against the prophets who steal from one another words supposedly from me. Yes, declares the Lord. I am against the prophets who wag their own tongues and declare, the Lord declares, indeed, I am against those prophets with false dreams, declares the Lord. They tell them and lead my people astray with their reckless lies, yet I did not send or appoint them. They do not benefit these people in the least, declares the Lord. What more can I say? What more can I say? Go to Isaiah. Isaiah chapter 8. Isaiah chapter 8, there verse 20. I'll go to verse 19. When someone tells you to consult mediums and spirits who whisper and mutter, should not a people inquire of their God? Why consult the dead on behalf of the living? Consult God's instruction and the testimony of warning. If anyone does not speak according to this word, they have no light in them. What does it say? Don't go to another person to understand. If anyone does not, go back, verse 20. Consult God's instruction and the testimony of warning. What is God's instruction? It is the word of God. It is the Bible. It's here. In 1844-85, there was a big news item. Let's talk about spirits. There was a home where people could hear knocking on the wall. And people would come from all over the place, even Europe, to go and see this house. And there at night in the darkness, they could hear knocking on this wall. And Ellen White got involved in that story. And she says that she has been shown by God that there is a spirit of some dead person who was murdered in that house. And that spirit is on the wall, knocking on the wall. Published, this is published material. When this story kind of got out of hand, there were two young ladies who lived in that house, the Fox sisters. They explained that initially they were causing that knock with an apple they had on the other side with a thread stuck to it. Later, they were able to make that noise with their big toes to go click, click, because their bones used to click, their joints used to click. And against the wall, they could make it sound like it was knocking. But Ellen White says that these are spirits of the dead that God had shown her. Prophet of God cannot be wrong. The prophet of God must be right every time. Every time. Go to Matthew 24. Matthew 24, we'll close with this. We are warned by Jesus Christ himself that the work believers have been given to do is to preach the gospel. The last thing Jesus said before he left Matthew 28 was what? All power in heaven and on earth is given to me. Go ye therefore, teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Not to scare people about the last day events. Not to focus on the coming of Christ. Not to be preoccupied with what's happening to the end of the world. Because Ellen White taught that Jesus was going to come when she was still alive. She also said she was going to be one of the 144,000. Then when she died, other Adventists began to teach, oh, before Jesus comes, Ellen White will be resurrected so she can be part of the 144,000. Because she said so. Just the fact, my friend, if you're an Adventist, just the fact that the name of the organization is Adventist shows the preoccupation with the last days and the trying to determine when Jesus is coming, that in itself is unbiblical. The world knows Adventists as Seventh-day Adventists. The fact that they're Seventh-day Adventists only tells you what kind of Adventist. But what are you? You're an Adventist. That's what you are. There are First-day Adventists as well. They were there at the time of Ellen White. I have two German shepherds. Well, one's a German shepherd. The other is a Czechoslovakian shepherd. But guess what? They're both dogs. But they're different kinds of dog. What kind of dog? One's a Czechoslovakian shepherd and the other is a German shepherd. But they're dogs. As such, somebody who is looking only to the coming of Christ and preoccupied with everything that happens in this world, oh, there's a sign now that the world is coming to an end. And this is how the evangelists and the preachers bring people into the church. The world is coming to an end. You better be ready. Because you won't be sealed by the Sabbath. My gosh. Horrible teachings. Horrible teachings. When Jesus gives the last day events in Matthew 24, the reason he gives it and he follows through with that story in Matthew 25, that discussion continues. The conclusion of that story, he says, here are the signs. But he says in verse 36, but when he's finished with all the signs, let's go to verse 34, truly I tell you, this generation will certainly not pass away until these things happen. Heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will never pass away. Here's a big but. Verse 36, but about that day or hour, no one knows, not even the angels in heaven, nor the Son, but only the Father knows. Only the Father knows. So if you have a preoccupation that carries a title Adventist with your denomination, go back and study the scripture. The very foundation of the name and the entire purpose behind this denomination was non-biblical. Why do you have to stick to these lies? Why? Accept the gospel of Jesus Christ, the good news. Get away from this gospel of destruction that the Apostle Paul talks about. This other gospel. He says, cursed is everybody who brings you this other gospel. I can tell you without a doubt, cursed is Ellen White. And every pastor and every teacher who teaches those teachings. And I invite you, my friends. I have friends and relatives who are leaders and pastors in the church. I invite you to go and study. If you want to talk with me publicly or in private, do so. But examine your hearts. Not only for your sake, but because you're leading other people down the wrong path and away from the gospel of Jesus Christ. We hope in this little congregation that we will continue to study the Word of God. And through His Word, God will open our minds and hearts. That the Spirit of God will lead us through Scripture to continue to dig. That the reformation that was started may continue in our hearts, in our homes, and in our congregations. That we may be led to the foot of the cross of Jesus Christ. Why? Because the law shows me my sin and points me to Jesus Christ. And the Holy Spirit comes into my heart when I accept Jesus Christ. And it is He who begins to transform me. And the old man dies. And the new man begins to grow like a little child who falls as he's learning how to walk. He makes mistakes, but stands before God pure. Hebrews tells us we can go into God's throne of grace boldly, boldly. We will talk more about the doctrines in detail in weeks to come. Next week, we will continue with the story of Ellen White so that there's no doubt left. Because if we can show that Ellen White herself was a false prophet, than those doctrines that are unbiblical in the Seventh-day Adventist Church need to be thrown out of practice of any Christian believer. May God grant that you study your word. Don't throw stones at me until you have studied. And when you have, let's discuss. May God bless you. I ask you to pray for me as I pray for you through these difficult and trying times as we study God's word. God bless you.